I'm here with Mark Baird. My name is Terry Raposa. And we're going to talk about something that maybe a lot of people haven't been able to put their finger on or understand. But what we're going to talk about is our contract for liberty. You want to tell us what that is, Mark?
Yes. Liberty is an elusive concept, and it's a concept that a lot of people don't understand. And as a very, very well-known constitutional educator recently said, if you can't define liberty, how can you defend it? And if you cannot define tyranny, how can you defeat it? Liberty consists of the inalienable rights. These are rights that John Locke talked about hundreds of years ago when he said that some laws were derived from God and some rights were passed into our hearts at the moment of our creation. Marcus Cicero, a Roman senator, once said that not all laws are on paper. Some laws are written in the hearts of men. Those are the inalienable rights, our rights to life, to liberty, to property. In fact, our Bill of Rights consists of the inalienable rights. Those are the rights that were placed in the Constitution in order that government never trespass in that ground. And as we can see, 238 years later, liberty does not mean the same thing now that it once meant when the framers created the contract we call the Constitution. So we have to take ourselves back because, as Thomas Paine said, I have not but the light of history to guide my feet. I don't know what the future holds. I can only look back to see what has happened up until now. So we have to go back into history in order to understand the concept of liberty. Liberty was very important to our framers. In fact, it was the most important thing that they envisioned the Constitution protecting. First, we have a situation where we have a country and we have rulers for that country. But we have to remember that government didn't come before the people. The people came before government. Mm-hmm. People created the contract with government, and they created it for one reason. We were willing to entrust some of our freedoms. We were willing to delegate some of that responsibility to government. Now, when you look up the word delegate, it means a temporary trust. We allowed government to take temporary control of some of our freedoms for one reason and one reason only, in order to secure and protect the liberty that we hold most dear. Now, the founding fathers, the way they looked at that, all property rights are inalienable rights. In other words, your right to life, your life is your property. Well, what good is your life if someone can take your life anytime they want because you lack the tools to defend it? What good is your right to free speech, your intellectual property, if the government after the fact can tell you, well, you only have free speech in this area or in that area, or you have to go behind this building to have free speech in the free speech zone? We came originally to this country to protect our right to worship Christ in our own way. Religious freedom, a property right again. When we came to this country, we realized very quickly that we needed a common voice because as disparate individuals and disparate groups, we lacked the unity in order to fend off foreign attackers and fend off raids on our commerce and overfishing off our shores. So literally, the people created government in order to secure the liberty that they held most dear. Now, once the King of England became intolerable, and he passed a series of laws which subjugated the people, we obviously had a rebellion starting in 1775, and it was a very bloody war. And what we did during that war was we came to some common conclusions that we were united colonies. But as of July the 2nd, not July the 4th, like a lot of people believe, the Lee Amendment was actually adopted, or the Declaration of Independence was adopted on July the 2nd. Mm. And on July the 2nd, we declared ourselves free from subjugation of Great Britain. We declared the United Colonies were now the free and sovereign states of the United States, equal on the world stage to any other national government. And as those people, we created a government in order to protect the liberties that we hold most dear. Now, here's the important part in this jurisdictional chain. People came before government. People created government in order to accomplish certain things. And most of those things were external to our borders. We wanted common voice in foreign attacks, war, peace, treaties, to regulate foreign commerce. That's what the national government was designed to do. Well, let's fast forward about 10 years or so. And now we come to the place where we, the sovereign and independent states of the United States, created by the people, people, states, federal government, we the people, in order to create a more perfect union. That's a very interesting statement. When you really look at that and you read it word for word, you ask yourself, why did they say that? Why didn't they just say, we the people, in order to create a union? They said a more perfect union. That's interesting. The reason is because we had a union before the Constitution, and it didn't work. We had the Articles of Confederation. We had 10 presidents of the United States before George Washington. You don't learn that in school anymore. Your children are not being taught liberty in school anymore. So when the Articles of Confederation were enacted, it was very clear very quickly that they weren't going to work. They didn't serve the people. Right. Here's where our ultimate jurisdiction comes from. As signers of that contract, when the contract failed to serve the people, we abolished it. And we, the people, in order to form a more perfect union, created the Constitution of the United States. When we created that Constitution, we the people as sovereign states, the product of that Constitution was the federal government. And literally in the state of California, why did the people of the state of California form this state? Why didn't we just stick with Mexico? Why didn't we leave things the way they were? Well, when you read the preamble to the Constitution, in other words, the reason we created Constitution, that's what the preamble says. Why do we need to do this? We, the people of the state of California, grateful to Almighty God for our freedom and to secure it, that freedom, we create this Constitution. So we, the people of the state of California, in order to secure our liberty, created the state of California. Well, by inference, what is the state of California's purpose? Its purpose is to secure our liberty. Mm-hmm. And how does it do that? The state of California is supposed to stand between the people and the product of the Constitution, the federal government. States created the federal government, not the other way around. Is the federal government now superior to its creators? Is the state of California superior to its creators? Who are the creators of the contract? The people. Are we now less than the government we created? Do we have a government that's supposed to serve us, or do we have a government now that is superior to us and subjugates us? That's the reason for the contract, to secure liberty. And in the Constitution, in the final paragraph of the Declaration of Independence, we are securing liberty at the cost of our blood, our treasure, and our sacred honor. The Constitution of the United States, when government fails to serve the people, it's their duty and responsibility to abolish it and institute forms of government more favorable. Mm-hmm. Article 1, Section 1 of the California Constitution, we're born free and independent beings, and we have certain inalienable rights. Those rights supersede statutes, supersede regulations, supersede legislation. They are rights given us by God, like the preamble says, and we form this Constitution in order to protect those inalienable rights, those liberties. Because without liberty, what do you care about the money? The government won't allow you to keep the money. Without liberty, what do you care about property? It's meaningless. You don't own your property, you just rent it from the government. And the minute you stop paying that rent, they're going to take your property away. If you don't have liberty, none of the rest of it matters. Article 2, Section 1 of the California Constitution. All just power is derived from the people, and whenever government fails to serve the people, they have the right to alter that government or abolish it. So the people in this picture have all of the power and government's only purpose is to serve the people. Well, I asked the people of the state of Jefferson, of the 13, 14, 15, however many counties want liberty in the North State, does the government of California serve you? Because it does not serve me. And we need to form a constitutional republic that serves the individual, that protects his right to property, that protects his liberty, because liberty is free. You didn't pay for it. It was a gift. It was a gift from your fathers and your forefathers. And they paid for it with their blood, their treasure, and their sacred honor. And what is the cost of that liberty? Eternal vigilance. And if we don't secure liberty for our posterity the way it was secured for us, we have no one but ourselves to blame when our children and our grandchildren grow up in a place that we don't even recognize. We envision a state where the counties have the lion's share of the power, where you, the individual, instructs your elected representative directly in meetings where you can see him and look him in the eye, him or her, and you tell them, we are in a position to educate our children, not someone 500 or 2,700 miles away. We want our children to learn about morality and liberty. We want them to learn mathematics and science and art and history, and not the way Common Core teaches it. We in our counties know that we can make responsible use of our resources, and we have the power to do that. We're here. We have the wisdom, the knowledge, the local talent, the local governmental support to do those things. We should not be directed from 900 or 3,000 miles away. That's what the contract represents in the state of Jefferson. And that contract, contrary to California's constitution, which has been altered 521 times in 163 years, the constitution of the state of Jefferson is going to be extremely difficult to change, so that successive loads of politicians won't be able to alter the contract away from the constitution of liberty and to embrace the cause of the day. And Judge Posner from the Seventh Circuit said, it is possible for evil to enter the legal system when jurists embrace the cause of the day. We must secure liberty, and we must safeguard liberty at all costs, because without liberty, none of the rest of it matters.
Time has come for 51.
Time has come for 51, the state of Jefferson.